Coming this evening, it's Saturday evening, so much traffic outside, and for you to spare the time to come and share this very special moment, it means a lot to us. You're all hugely loving and caring friends of mine, and I really appreciate it that you've come. It's also very comforting for us that we have Mita's husband here, Dr. Samiran Nandi, my brother-in-law and chairperson of the Institutional Review Board. We have Shurujit, Mita's son, my nephew, and a member of the IRB. And we've got various members of the IRB here. We've got the co-chairperson, Farooq, Udwadia, Veera, Armida, and a lot of other people, Dr. Urvashi Chal. And so please excuse me if I don't mention each and every one, but we're very, very grateful to you that you're here to share a few moments with us. I just want to say, for those of you who don't know, didn't know Mita, she was quite an extraordinary person, you know, in the sense that she was a very, very accomplished person, great pianist and painter and an intellectual, she's a researcher. She was better than me in everything. She was better in writing, she was better in speaking extemporary, she was better in piano. The only thing is I beat her in tennis, so that was the only thing. But she was quite extraordinary, and the main thing is that although she's passed away 10 days ago, her presence is very vibrant with us, because for every event, everything that happened to us, she had her own philosophy, her ideology, her spiritual values, which she expressed quite freely. You know, so that remains with us, the spiritual spirit of Mita remains with us, though she has left us physically. And for those of you who may not know, that Mita was the first from Spastic Society India, Mumbai. And she actually was sitting in the courtyard in Afghan Church. And that is why we are having the prayer meeting of 5 to 6 early morning. And I remember her clearly sitting at the back with Malini on her lap. She was also, of course, as many of you know, she was the founder, chairperson of the Delhi Spastic Society, or it was called the Spastic Society of Northern India. But this meeting, hey, disabled mic, so, it's a celebration. It was a great privilege for us. With a spirit like Mita. They've called it Remembering Mita. And I'm trying to capture some of her multifaceted, you know, personality.
She was, as I said, very accomplished
and an intellectual, a researcher, and an extraordinary mix. Very stunning, as you will see, of course, in the AV that I'm going to show you. And she's a great cook. But I must tell you that she really drove Samiran and the kids quite crazy when she was entertaining. She excelled herself as a hostess, but very meticulous about each and every detail of the linen, the food, the way it's going to be cooked, prepared, presented, the crockery, So after any event like that, they'll say no more parties. You know, because Mita was so very particular. As far as I'm concerned, of course, there was another side to her. She was deeply religious, deeply spiritual. I think amongst all of us, she really was very, very deep in her care, her compassion and her love. And she was constantly going out to feed the lepers. But she couldn't do enough. In all her 70 years, she couldn't do enough of service. And I think this is what she has left behind, the fact that she believed in all religions. And that is why the prayer meeting tomorrow has got all faiths who are coming, the priests coming. Okay. Me, of course, my memories go back when we were children, you know, early days. We came from a very closely knit privileged family, and my parents inculcated all their values. And my mother was constantly dragging us to ashrams. And I remember from the age of six, no exotic holiday, just ashrams and waking up at 4 and 5 for prayers. And really, it was quite interesting because it was the pre-independence time. So there was a mantra that serve India, you have to serve India, and you have to go beyond yourself. And there was constantly the mantra that the right is to work only and not to the fruits. And so I think a lot of all of us, you know, the culture and the society, the family, it influences us a lot. My father was very influenced by British rationalism and the culture of arts, theatre, etc. Result was us, unfortunately. We knew more about Keats, Shelley, and Wordsworth than Ramayana and Mahabharata. I don't know, I shouldn't be saying this at this time, but maybe people like us will be all moved out of this country, but that is how it was. But in school, she was quite rebellious, very rebellious about authority. And she would always question the nuns. And I remember one particular event when she was being scolded. She took the nun's umbrella and ran away. And instead of just letting her go, Mother Bernadine ran after her. And she ran through the campus, made her really dodge trees and various bushes, climbed over, and Mother was so very, very disappointed that she called Mother and my mother and said, "I'm very, very disappointed with her. Is she really Shoma and Juni?" You see, she was always being compared to my sister Juni, and so she said that we can't imagine them being related because we were the goody-goody ones. And so she was so tired of being compared all the time to Mitra and Julia that she decided on her own, I want to give up studies. I don't want to go anywhere, no college, where Mitra and Julia are there. So she gave up college and decided to become a secretary. And in fact, Shomran was just telling me about the marriage when he married her. May I remind you, Shomran, that she was an excellent secretary. And she soon rose and became the secretary to the managing director of IBM. I remember when she first got her paycheck, she came bounding up to me and threw the money. Even then, she was not one bit interested in money. And she said, "It's all yours. And let's celebrate." And how do we celebrate? "Let's get some kati kebabs." Probably 2 rupees or something. she then went on to, she loved traveling. So she quickly applied and she was chosen as one of the, this is for the World Fair. So she went off to the World Fair in New York.
And after that, she
didn't
want to come back. So she became one of the guides for the United Nations. then she just loved New York so much that she said, little old New York, and she didn't want to come back, and her mother insisted and dragged her back to India. She stayed for a couple of years and got very tired and again wanted to travel, and applied to British Airways to be an air hostess, and was really fed up because she said, she Indians who kept on saying water, water, and all that, she wouldn't know because she wouldn't know. So she didn't like that job very much, but she secretly had applied for it because she wanted to meet up with Dr. Nundy. Can you imagine, in London? So she worked that out, and then she went to the parents and said, what can I do? I've got this job. And then, you know, she always secretly did all this. She knew she wouldn't get permission.
And so she left her home, a very nurturing home, and she married Samiran, and at the age of 21. And Dr. Nundy, my parents were very, very pleased, and because they knew Dr. Nundy from the age of 17. Dr. Nundy remembers this, you know. And my mother would always take him under her wing, and so we were delighted when Mita got married and left for Cambridge. Dr. Nundy did everything to actually get her back to studies. So then she did her A-level. And she, of course, again excelled in the A-level. I quite remember her bicycling around Cambridge and juggling with her piano lessons and her A-level and shepherding me because I was very timid, just the opposite of Mita. Mita was supremely confident. And I was so timid, I wouldn't even know what to say to the butcher, because in those days you have to go to the butcher and give them quickly a list of all the things you want. I was very nervous about that, so I would stand at the back and tell her, you go first. And perhaps I've changed a little bit now, hopefully. Then of course, Samiran went on to Hammersmith Hospital, where both the boys were born, and I mean, I can't imagine we were also pregnant together. So Shurjit and Nikhil were born in Hampshire. And the funny thing is that there's only the month or 2 months difference between them. And after that, after the move to London, Mita goes on to London School of Economics to finish her degree. And the first thing she does is revive the Krishna Menon Society. And then, of course, she goes in for Masters, MPhil, PhD, and excelled in that. She registered for the PhD and she got a scholarship. And I just find it very hard to understand how she was so good at LSE, because when I went as a visiting academic, I felt terribly lost. You know, it's perhaps suicidal depression if you feel intellectually bereft, and I definitely felt that, but not her. So, but I told you that she was much, much more clever, much more accomplished than I was. When we played the piano, we did the Trinity College music exam, and I would come back and I said, I think the examiner really liked me, you know. My performance went very well. And she would be quite quiet and all, not say anything. In the end, she beat me every time, every exam. She got some in the 90s. Anyway, I'm running. But let me just tell you, the most momentous thing I think happened in our lives was when Malini was born. And that was quite interesting to see how the entire family responded, you know, because my sister-in-law, after the Bombay model, went pushed off to West Bengal and said, how can I help? And started the Calcutta Spastic Society with Sudha Kaur. And she's now no more. She died in 1986. In fact, her husband is here, my brother at the back. And her wonderful, talented daughter, Shonali Antia. My sister, she started the Spastic Society of Northern India. with a whole lot of luminaries, Anita Shori, Minu Jalan, Radhika Roy, Manju Dubey, and at present carrying on the work is Gloria, Shamla and Vandana. But what was interesting, Samiran was the chairperson, and then Samiran was asked to step down and Mita became the chairperson. And should I say about this particular incident, but yeah, this is an extraordinary journey with grandmothers and mothers-in-law and Anita Shodi's mother, Shomiran's mother, Mrs. Nandi, all of that I've tried to capture in the AV, so you'll see them and Anita Shodi's mother, Malti Mashi, everyone. So I think the most important thing is that she painted this canvas and she left a tremendous original innovative stamp in her work. She, I really respect the fact that she became detached from what she had done. She built a beautiful building and a beautiful institution. It was as, you know, big and beautiful as you see here. But she didn't, after she left, she would get very cross if they said that, you know, it was Mrs. Nandi, nothing. She said, no, nothing. It was some, you know, big divine intervention. So that, I think, is where I just feel terribly humbled. I feel that here is someone who worked for nothing and who didn't even want her name there and who didn't want prestige, power, nothing. And so I think that is what we really are celebrating, the spirit and the fact that we came in touch with someone like that. And finishing off, returning to her loved ones, she was very, very proud of Shivajit and who just passed out as doctor from Harvard Medical College and also got a PhD, you know, so now we don't have that. She was the only person in the family who has that. Shiva, I hope I'm saying the right things. And of course, the other thing is that he's going to be starting a very interesting, innovative thing in the country for health statistics, health patient record, etc., which is going to be affecting millions of poor people to get the health record immediately, possibly on mobile phones. She's very proud of Karuna, daughter, University of Cambridge, UC Cavendish, and then on to Columbia, and Supreme Court lawyer. But in all her life, all her busy life, she never ever lost her thoughtfulness, her sensitivity, and her care for Malini, the resident for which she joined the disability movement. And she was always writing and being in touch and very proud at the end of her days now that Malini had a job in London. And I'm not sure about everyone, but I'm sure those who are close to the Nandi family know that they're two darling grandchildren who she loved. She enjoyed that in the end. Noor and Mishk, and Shurojit and Mandakini, her wonderful daughter-in-law's children. But I think I end with saying, of all things, she adored her husband. She was so meticulous about the care for Shomiran. She crafted everything around, structured everything around Shomiran. And each meal was planned by for Shomiran. Am I right, Shomiran?
No.
And so, I mean, although she herself was a vegetarian, but everything that Shomiran liked, you know, be it lobster, prawns, crab, everything, she planned it, she often cooked it, and it was always there for Sam. His his clothes, his shoes, his everything. It was a meticulous care. I think she rather spoiled Samiran actually. But there you are, she did do that. She never wavered for a moment as far as her care for Samiran, her devotion to Samiran. And what of poor Samiran? Poor Samiran, as soon as he landed in Cambridge, it was like being married to a mob, because I arrived with my 1.5-year-old disabled child, and the person who really did everything was Sam. He found the right doctors, the right treatment. He shepherded us through all the assessments, and he set that all up. And I think he never ever stopped actually being the rock that he is with his family. He says all that, but he's really been behind every single person who's got ill here, has also been a father figure to Malini and Nikhil. But most importantly, he stood by Mita when Mita got amyloids. I mean, he was all over the world, Johns Hopkins and Mayo, and he played a key role to keep her alive. And we were only told that she'd live for another year or 2 years, etc. And of course, as you know, that Mita lived for 30 years. And I think in the last moments, I clearly remember how Sam would be always lying on the floor. And it's quite interesting that in her last moment, when he went and asked her, how are you, etc., she said, I'm much better. And she repeated to him, I'm much, much better. I think that what was extraordinary is that she herself switched off. And I mean, the pacemaker was on, everything was working. But she herself willed herself really to leave us and move at that time. And because I saw her 3 days before she passed away, and I was in touch with each and every member because I was going frantic. That should I come back, you know? But they all said, no, she's doing well and she's all right. But somewhere at night, Mita switched off and decided, no, it is time for me to leave. And for me, I think that I was so lucky and so fortunate that from the age of 1.5, I was in touch with such a wonderful, extraordinary spirit. And what I so admire, and I hope God gives me a little bit of that element of hers, that not only did she stand by me, supporting me right throughout, through every storm, but she painted a canvas for the whole country, for millions of people with disability, families of disability, and chose to remain anonymous. So therefore, it is to that spirit, to that wonderful, exceptional person that I pay a tribute, and I thank you all for sharing this moment with me. Thank you. Tell you that there are one or two people who have actually worked very closely with Mita. So I'm going to ask them to just spend 1 or 2 minutes to tell you about that. I think there's someone called Asha who has actually been in all the 4 spastic societies and is now in charge of the Bandra Center. And she knew Mita from the age of 19. So, would you like to take that? So, she has a story to tell, and I'm sure you'll find that quite interesting.
Good evening, everyone. My story is not very long. When I think of Mita Di, what comes to mind is the first time that I met her. heartwarming smile and her clarity of thought and her contagious energy. And that remained with me throughout the time that I worked with Adi or the Spastic Society of Northern India. That stint lasted for about 14 years. But that first impression was a lasting impression, and it got reinforced throughout the years that I worked with her. I worked with her closely on certain presentations, and I worked with her as part of the Adi family. When we had meetings at Adi, you know, we all sat on the floor. I mean, that's how she had her meetings. She said we should sit on the floor. Like, she was really well grounded then. And what she said was, if you have an idea, you know, in the meeting, if you have an idea, you have to express it, either through action or through words. But don't keep it to yourself. That's being very selfish. Your idea may be stupid, but it'll have an impact on people. You know, then they'll feel that they're cleverer than you. But whatever it is, you have to express your idea. I think that is one thing that I've learned from her, that if you have an idea, express it in whatever form, you know, you can. And I remember some of these meetings, we used to sit on the floor and then some child will be crying or something will be happening and she'll just run off. You know, she'll leave her slippers behind and she'll just run and see what's going on. And then there'll be staff members running behind her, "Mita di, your shoes, your slippers." But she didn't care. So, you know, she was so, I think, attached and so in contact and so caring that she gave herself the last thought. I mean, whatever was first in her mind was that something is happening and I can do something to help. And she would just, you know, instinctively go there. She was also very caring about staff. She was highly motivated, and that motivation was again contagious. She'd get new ideas. She'd say, okay, like Mithu said, she was kind of a rebel. There were standardized tests to do, and she said, who cares about that? They tried to standardize it to our children. There were tests which were in English, and in Delhi it was mostly Hindi speaking. She said, translate it, do a research. You know, she was always research oriented. And we were like kids saying, no, Mita, you know, research is too tough. She said, no, get 100 people. Try out these tests on 100 people. Do the English version, do the Hindi version. See if they match. And say, are they on par in those days? So we standardized certain tests for Adi. And when we did assessments, I mean, you know, it didn't go anywhere. We weren't wrong anywhere. We were getting the right results. So she was brave that way, and she gave us that courage also to move forward. I also worked with her personally when I had to present a paper. I used to go to her house. I think that time you had a ground floor house. And she used to say, come at breakfast time. And then she forced me to have tea and toast. And she said, now do your paper. And then at the workplace, we would sit again, and then she'd be cutting mangoes and peeling. I thought, you know, maybe she has to keep up with her diet. But she was cutting that for me. You know, it was so strange, and I used to feel very awkward that, you know, she's doing such things for me when, you know, she's my boss, and I should be doing such things for her. So she was so caring, and she always had this leveled or equal playing field. And I think that also encouraged us to, you know, do the best. Be the best while you're there. Do the best you can. You know, and I speak for all the staff who worked with me at Adi. If you say Mita Di, they say, yes, okay, I know what Mita Di is saying. It'll happen. There were some quirks also she had, and we had little misgivings about some of her skills. One of them was her driving skills. You know, when we used to go for, when we went for picnics, all the cars will be full. And they say, Mita Ji say, who's coming with me? Who's coming? And nobody's there. You know, because she'd drive into a tree or she'd drive into a pole. So everyone was scared to go with her. But you know, she was so full of life, and the joie de vivre really translated into action, and we could see it every day. So it was a pleasure really working with her, and it was very intellectually stimulating as well. We had a lot of discussions and critiquing and arguments, but it always ended successfully, and we were always able to come out of it feeling very, very good. The other aspect of her, like Mithu said, her spirituality, and I think she also cared. You know, she must have gone through stress while working with people with disability and the long hours and the, you know, physically strenuous work as well. So we used to have one day in a week, that was a Wednesday, for meditation. We had a meditation room. And anybody who wanted to go and calm down or de-stress was asked to go there. And there was all the saints and all the gods were there, of all the religions. There was one room, one nice hall. We all sat on the floor. Incense sticks were burned. And we just meditated silently. Or we said a prayer. And that lasted for half an hour, 45 minutes. And she also said, if anybody is stressed, if you have anything to say, please say it here and then you will calm down. So I think that once a week meditation thing was looked forward to by everybody. And sometimes we were very busy with sessions, so we couldn't go. But somehow or the other, once a month or twice a month, at least we made it to the meditation chamber. I think that also, you know, helped us understand ourselves a lot more, and we were able to give a lot more. She was an amazing person. So I think I have to say that I've been blessed that I got an opportunity to work with her. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Amena Latif. I think she saw her from the age of 15.
Amena, I would rather read what I said, but I'm a little more clearer when I read than when I speak. I'm sorry. Okay. I've known Mita Nundy for many, many years, and each and every one of us associated with the Spastics Society of India is truly bereaved by her passing away. Despite her stroke and illness, Mita Nundy's spirit was ever smiling. Her greeting and behavior continued to be brave and cheerful throughout. Every parent and child, like Asha said, will remember her as someone who was always there to hear and take care of their problems each day, each time. Mita Nundy, as I know her, was a fun-loving, outgoing person. She was a spiritual person and in an eclectic way. I remember her as a person who never forced her spiritual beliefs on anyone, but all known to her felt a deep belief. Mita Nundy will always be remembered fondly in all our hearts.
Thank you so much, Amena. She will always remember you as well. Manju, you have something also that you did with Mita?
Would you like to use this?
Good evening. I'm Manju Chatterjee. You know, it is said that some people are bound to meet, to work together, to help the poorest of poor. I thought I was doing my bit of social service by being part of the DAP family. But when I met Mita Nundy, she changed. She guided me to go beyond my daily work routine and help me start the Bal Vikas. She provided me with all the books, all the cassettes, and she told, yes, start this. So from then we started having a Bal Vikas at Kulaba Center. Every Thursday we have a Bal Vikas. All those gurus come, they keep telling all nice stories, those little books are still there of everyone. Students enjoy, they sing the bhajans also. And with her in the evenings, you know, she used to say, no, you have got time, you come out, we'll go. So we used to go to church gate at Fani Banda's house. And there I used to be there with her for the bhajans. You know, it really got lots of peace. And her smile, which I can never forget. She used to always smile. I still feel her presence. She's still with us. Whenever, every Thursday when we have those gurus coming and doing it, I still feel Mita Nundy is with us.
Thank you so much, Manju. I'm sure that she is with you. We've got a message from Malini. I'm not sure if that's coming on. Is that coming on? What is happening? Shall we give you, is Nikhil is reading it? Is Malini coming on?
Not sure, they're trying one last
thing. Huh?
They're trying one last thing.
Still trying. Okay, the poor child is sitting in London and wanting to come, but she's written something which her brother has decided to read.
So I'm going to start by reading some thoughts that my sister sent from London about aunt who we used to call Mashi. Mashi, do you remember when I was born and you carried and sang to me the stories and the songs you used to sing to me in order to silence me from bowling? You used to carry me in your arms. Mashi, in the morning when I awaked in Cambridge, I used to straight away bunny hop and climb onto your and Mashi's bed. I used to always be left alone with you. Mashi, do you remember when I was walking with you in Marina and you sang God Save the Queen and I fell? You were both very frightened of Mum and didn't tell her. Mashi, you gave me the name Molly. Mum said, don't spoil my lovely daughter's name. You named me after Molly Malone. Mashi, I used to spend all Diwali holidays with you reading romances. You made me come to SSNI and talk to the children, and I used to meet and chat about my experiences, which gave them solace to their parents also. Like most women, the work you did went unrecognized. You created a magnificent building for disabled children and families. You with Dad started the ball rolling for the Persons with Disability Act. Were you ever recognized or credited? No, but you wanted to remain anonymous, always. Mashi, you always used to say I was your eldest daughter. You were automatic in seeing to my needs. Mashi, I will miss you. The hours we spent laughing, shopping, and doing all those mundane things. I hope you've gone to a better place, which we don't know.
I think there's something that Varsha would like to say, but before that, I think her best friend, Bobby, has sent a very touching letter, which I thought Sathi, because we are very close to Bobby as well, but Bobby is really Mita's sort of best friend in London. They were together at the United Nations as well, as guides.
I think they were guides in the United Nations when it was fashionable in those days to have country representatives, and Mita was there from India, and Bobby was American, and she had just set up a home in Manhattan, and Mita was house guest and stayed for some time. And I think it's probably one of the deepest friendships that Mita cultivated and Bobby reciprocated, because that's a friendship which is not between two individuals, but it's spawned a family bonding where all of us have been Bobby's guests in London. Bobby's home in London has been our home in London. And so for Bobby, it's like losing a sister as well. So Bobby sent a message to my family, and I'm going to read it. I'm sending my deepest condolences on the sad occasion of Sushmita's death. She was a most special and beautiful person who lived with love, humility and compassion for all, and with a sister me too, her person whose life really did make a difference in changing the world for the better. My heart goes out to all of her family who have nurtured Mita as she bravely lived and struggled with a terrible illness over a period of several decades. Your loss is profound. At last she is in peace and most likely in a blissful place with all of the other saints. Her legacy of good works is vast, and she has left with us her wonderful husband and gifted children who continue to contribute so much to help other people to have healthier lives and to enjoy equal rights under the law. I will never forget the beautiful and bright young woman with a dazzling smile who was my roommate in New York in 1965. I loved her idealism, her dreams of a fairer world, and her unbounded love for India. I loved her playing fair release on the piano every day, her gorgeous and light-hearted sense of humor, her sharing her family's Burmese recipes with me. I cooked, Bobby says, and the way in which we brought so much joy, fun, friendship and ancient and modern Indian history into my life. My whole life has been forever enhanced by my beautiful young roommate, Mita. Also to all of the gorgeous and exceptional people I was lucky enough to get to know because of our friendship, including Bina, Samiran, Surajit, Koruna, Mithu, Molly, Nikki, Sathi, Sumitra and her mom Nikki. Mita's spirit will always be with us and she will be forever present in our hearts. On my love, welcome.
Thank you so much, Sathi. So I think we come to the last reminiscence from Varsha, who's also been very close to Mita in the last few years.
Good evening. I'm Varsha Hooja and I've been with the Spastics Society of India for about 30 years, and that's how long I have known Mita Di. It would be impossible for anyone to be in the disability movement and not have heard of Mrs. Mita Nundy. And my association with her, unfortunately, not really professional like Asha shared, but it was a deep personal relationship. And I have very fond memories of arguments and debates and shared meals that we had together. Every time that I was in Delhi, I either had a meal at her place or she would come to the India International Center where we stayed and have a meal with us. Our last meal was 5 days before she passed away. But on a wheelchair, ill, she still enthusiastically came to the IIC dining room and ordered her favorite soup, which we then shared. Values is what I remember of Mita Di the most. She had these very strong values. I remember her telling me to send my daughter for Chinmaya classes because she said she has to grow up with Indian values and has to learn the Indian philosophy. I also remember her trying very hard to convince me to turn vegetarian, and we had a lot of arguments on that. She had this childlike enthusiasm and appreciation of everything. I mean, it could be a piece of music or, you know, a painting that got her attention, and she'd be so enthusiastic that you would forget any negative thought that you had. She was a And it's very difficult to still say was a very, very talented person. She was an excellent and accomplished pianist, and you'll hear some of the pieces, some of her favorite pieces in what Mita Di is going to put on now. And a beautiful painter. Even after her stroke, she did this beautiful Vanubal Gopal, which now I have on my phone. But what struck us the most was her spirituality. That was, it was not participation in organized religion or anything. It was personal prayers, it was meditation, it was reflection. It was not wanting to be in the limelight, it was pushing others. A very sweet story I heard now in Delhi from one of the professionals whom she really built up was that when they had team meetings, Mita Di would say, and someone got upset, Mita Di would say, "That's your ego talking, dear. Sit on it. Don't let it escape. You may get a little fat, but you'll be a better person for it." So she always, always had others come up. And a great Sai Bhakt. That was what gave her the courage, the strength. And she was the pillar of strength for her family and for all of us because she'd constantly guide us. So while, you know, there's tremendous sorrow right now at her passing away, there's also a gratitude for all the lives that she touched, all the school children for whom the school was built, all the parents whom she supported, all the professionals that she built up. So it's only fitting that we celebrate her life today because it's a life well lived. And as a tribute to her spirituality, we have just a couple of her bhajans that I'm going to now request Sharmila ji, Kayal ji, Shubha ji, Anurag and Nino to come up and sing for us.
Thank you. Sijananda.
We'll be singing Anondo Loke Mongola Loke, which is a Tagore song. I will just give the gist of the song. O Almighty God, you exist like a truth forever in the world of happiness and well-being in this universe. Your glory floods the endless sky and you rest at the bejeweled feet of this great universe. All the stars, planets, and the moon are eternally bathing in their immortal rays. You make this world beautiful with flowers, songs, and wonderful who's all around. Amidst this eternal beauty and splendor of your glory, the ceaseless cycle of life and death go on. O God, the world is blessed with your ever-flowing grace and kindness.
मंजूर रहे भगवन तुम्हारे
Just saying that we'll now be moving on to the evening. But before we do that, if there's anyone who would like to say anything, the most welcome. Yes?
Varsha already has taken the words from my mouth. You know, about Sai, and she got her strength from her guru, spiritual strength. Yeah, there's a tremendous, or what you may call it, depth to her spirituality. And that was what, you know, gave her the strength to, you know, be, she's shown me her spirit. So, but Shomiran's going to speak after us. So, you know, he's going to refute the. You'll have the last word, yes.
Excellent. Anyone else?
Arup,
do you want to say anything? Arup is a patriarch and a guru for all of us.
I'm not quite sure what to say. Death, I think, has a certain finality. It is probably the only certain thing in life. I don't know what happens after, no one knows, whether we just renew the earth or we go to another world. I am one who believes that we probably go to another world. And I'm sure Samiran, your wife, will inhabit it. I did not really know her. She came once when I had a talk in Delhi, and I was struck by her graciousness, her charm, and a rather faraway look in her eyes. Samiran tells me that she had a rare disease. I've seen a few of these. I've never seen them survive more than a couple of years at the outside. And I'm absolutely amazed when he says that she lived for 30 years after primary amyloidosis affecting the heart. I heard a lot about her from what you all taught. She must have been an exceptional soul, a blind spirit, if I may say so. One who's touched by music, I think, is set apart from the rest of us. And in addition to that, one who is so compassionate has looked after people who are not as privileged as most of us here, spiritual, deeply rooted in the roots of this country, kind, at the same time bubbling, enthusiastic, caring, helping others. How good, how more good can one be, if I may ask? An exceptional life. She suffered, I'm told, so Samiran tells me. But amazingly, I'm sure she would have taken her suffering as well as anyone else could. A life such as this indeed is fit for celebration. Veera and I send the near and dear ones, the whole family. We share in your grief, but remember, grievous though this separation will be, it is a life not only worth remembering,
worth emulating and worth celebrating. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prabhu. It means a lot to us that you and Veera were able to. We're now moving on to the AV, which actually just is a celebration of 70 years. So you'll see a lot of pictures when she was a baby and then how she grew up. The areas that I have talked about, after which the conclusion will be by Dr. Nandi. So can I ask you, Lucas, to put the AV on? And the lights off?
Shut up.
Now be told. But my wife and I were completely incompatible. She had absolutely no sense of humor, and I have a very sharp and brilliant sense of humor. She was very religious and a Hindu, and I am anti-religious and maybe a little Christian. But she was a terrible introvert, and nobody would ever accuse me of hiding my light under a bushel. She loved her family, and ever since we were married, we had the family hovering over us. I tell a lie, if we were together for 3 months in Cambridge, and then the family came. And since then, the family has always been with us. I tried to keep away from my family as much as I could. But she was very interested in the poor. I was interested in becoming rich. She was desperate to come back to India. And I was in Massachusetts General Hospital, golden boy, having done all this great stuff. But she insisted that I come back. He came back to 900 rupees a month in an E-type in the All India Institute. And you have to see an E-type to believe it. Because my mother, who used to live in a fairly large house in Calcutta, said
that she doesn't want to visit me again. She feels so sorry that after all the money she spent on my education in boarding school in Cambridge and all that, I've just sent it to an eater. And we constantly squabbled. We squabbled about money. We squabbled about whether the children should go to an English medium school or learn Hindi. We squabbled about whether they should be taught religion, how not should be taught religion. But at the end of 46 years, we actually got on quite well. And now that she's gone, thank you all for coming.
Thank you so much, Samiran, for those wonderful words. You've got a little lamp which you can light for, it's an electronic one. And if you'll just kindly light it and put it in front of Mita's thing. So I think, can we just begin from the last row? May I just ask you all to come? In case I don't get a chance, may I just say that we really, really appreciate the fact that on a Saturday evening you have taken time off from other much more exciting things and being with us to console us. So it means a lot, and thank you all very much for coming.
My dad was not.